So, we are ready to start. Yeah, thanks for being here. I'm happy to talk a little bit about blending open source and corporate values. And for me, it's nice how this conference pans out. We heard about community values at the beginning. We heard about how to build a community, research, some other things. And for me, it's interesting because it somehow reflects also my career in a way. So I started more than 20 years ago with more community work and got more and more into this industrial corporate world. And I want to talk about what happens if these open source culture meets the wall of the corporate office. What happens there? I'm working for DB Systel, which is the IT daughter of Deutsche Bahn. So that's about as big as a company you can find. And it's quite interesting how the culture of open source and corporate values blend. And that's what I want to talk about. The term which is usually used to describe that is inner source. So that's also a quite old term. Tim O'Reilly coined that in 2000. And he said, okay, it's inner source is using an open source-like culture, but within a company. So then the question is, what actually is this, the open source-like culture? And what are the corporate values, and how do they go together? And I want to go through a tour of these values and practices which are related to that, and then also talk a little bit about what we can do to actually make these blend better. So let's get started. What do you think is open source? Is it this? The creative chaos, the intuition, the hobby, the freedom, or is it that? The industrial production, the control, the professional work. What do you think? On which side are you? Do you have to pick a side? It's your decision. I would say open source, maybe it's on one side, maybe it's on the other side, maybe it's on both sides. Let's have a look. And I want to start with the perspective of open source values, because that's kind of the base. And we already heard a little bit about values, which I think is quite important. That's the base, which tells you a lot if things are compatible or not. And one core value of open source, obviously, is openness. That's clear. And it's related to freedom, the freedom to use, to study, to share, to improve software, which gives you an open project you can participate in. Also, standards are for me a part of openness, because that's a way, if you have standard ways how to interact, how to do things, that makes a project open, because you can easily understand how it works, and that makes it easier to participate again. And that's the last thing. Openness is a lot about being open in allowing people to participate, to lower the barrier for people to use your software, to contribute to your software, to be part of your community. Take part in what you're doing that. So creating this collaborative community which is working on something good together. So this openness, that's an important value in open source, and not only in software, but also over other projects. Another important value is transparency. So if you can look into what is happening, then you are able to learn. You are able to find out what others are doing. You can improve because you can see how other people are solving the same problem you might have. And this transparency makes it possible that you do that. It also leads to a way how you can follow what is happening. So this transparency in the process, that you can see how the cake is baked or whatever, or how the software is made, that helps you in understanding a project, and it also makes it again easier to participate if you want. And in sum, I would say transparency, that allows people to combine things. And there's this nice saying from Newton who said, okay, if I look farther than others, that's because I'm standing on the shoulders of giants, because I build on all the stuff people have built and may have made available, so I can look into it, use it, can reuse it, can use it for my purposes, and build on top of that, I can combine my contribution with the contributions of many others. And that's only possible if things are transparent. It also adds, and that's another thing which I think is quite important, this transparency, this value also is related to accountability. If people see what I'm doing, then I will probably do a good job in making sure that people see the right thing, and I don't hide the stuff which is crappy, but I do it in a good way. So transparency, an important value. And the third one, on kind of the open side, on the creative side, the collaboration. Collaboration is an important value. There's this, it's called Joyce's Law, that no matter where you are, most of the smartest people are not working for you. So it's no matter how big your company is, there are more smart people outside of that. So that means if you want to solve a big problem, better find a way how to collaborate with everybody, how to collaborate not only with the small part of the organization or the small part of the world you are a part of, but collaborate with all the people who can contribute to the solution of your problem. And that's even more important if you're talking really about big problems. But in general, it's, I think, an attitude how you can make collaboration to create value together. And then, of course, there are other things, and that's where the corporate values come into play. Of course, you also have to find a way how to make money and so on. But the collaboration is a very, very key part of that. And I would say in open source, it's a big value. Although what Matthias said at the beginning, I think is also right. It's also okay to not collaborate and sit in your basement and write a piece of software, but that's probably not the part companies are interested in or which is interesting in the context of inner source. So I also saw commitment on one of the slides today. I think that's also an important value, and that's maybe a little bit more surprising because it's not this, okay, open source is free and we do what we want and we do great things with no obligations. I think a lot of open source people are actually quite committed to what they do. They have skin in the game. They are the public face of a project. They directly interact with people. They have, maybe they are solving their own problem. So their brother is running his business on their software. So they have skin in the game. Another part is professionalism. Open source, sometimes you have this idea of, okay, that's these volunteers which do stuff for free and they are doing stuff just for fun. But a lot of open source developers are actually professionals and they get paid or they might not get paid for the concrete project, but there's a lot of people who are actually doing that for a living, what is happening in open source. And this creates also a sense of ownership. I think that's kind of the culmination of these attitudes you have there, that you feel ownership for your project, which you might not have if you are working for a company and you're just fulfilling a task, but it's something which a lot of people have. This is this inherent, this intrinsic motivation, which I think is quite dominant in people who really care about what they are doing in open source. Predictability is another value which you might not obviously expect in open source, but if you look at what is happening, actually, there are no secrets in open source because it's all open. There are no surprises. And this is actually something I learned from a project when I got involved, and they said, okay, we don't like surprises. And I think that's a great statement, because if there are no surprises in a project, then it's predictable. You know what will come. You can't do this marketing game of hiding things and then with a splash do a big release, but you are transparent in what you are doing. That makes you predictable. And many projects are actually quite predictable in what they are doing. They have a continuous release cycle, like OpenSUSE, for example. You have every 6 months or 9 months or whatever, and you get a new release, and you can count on that. And one of the big examples there is the Linux kernel. I find it amazing. I mean, that's a very predictable project. Every couple of months, there's a new release. There are thousands and thousands of changes in that. It's supported for a long time. There are distributions which are doing support for decades. So that's a very predictable and reliable project. And what I find interesting there is my simplistic interpretation of the Linux release culture. There's one maintainer, Linus Torvalds. He's doing that for almost 30 years. And he is releasing early, releasing often. That's a mantra. He started with that. They are still doing that, and it works. And that makes the project quite predictable. Although they don't really have a roadmap. There's no promise we will do that or this or that in the future. There's a process how to merge patches and so on. There's a policy to do no regressions. And this creates a predictable schedule, which actually billions of people rely on when they are using Linux all over the place. quite a corporate value, actually. And the last one, which might also be not that obvious, but I like it actually very much, compliance. That's something which always comes up in a corporate context. We have to be compliant with laws, with regulations, with everything. Open source people do that as well. If you think about legal questions, free software was founded not only as a technical thing, but very much as a legal construction. Not ignoring copyright, ignoring the law to share things, but actually using the law. Using the law to make software available with the freedoms it comes with. And that's something which requires that you are very careful with licenses, with the legal obligations of that. And that's what open source developers have learned and what they do. Open source developers know how to deal with licenses because that's what their model is based on. You don't often, or you often don't find that to that degree within a company, because there you have a lawyer which takes care of that, so you just write your code and you are done. But that's something actually which is quite healthy if you are aware of that. Same with code. Code is obviously the core of open source, but the way how people deal with code is something where there is a lot of compliance inherent. The standards open source developers put up on their code is quite high. The tools they use, they are quite sophisticated. Sometimes they even write their own tools for that. I mean, it's no accident, I would say, that Git as the dominant source code control system emerged from an open source project. And it's not only used by open source project, because it's really doing things on a very high level, and it makes it easy to be compliant, to make sure that you know where the code is coming from, who has written it, if everybody has the rights to do that, and so on. So this compliance is a high value, which I would say is quite visible in open source as well. There are more values like fun, like trust, like respect. And I think a lot of these values are visible in open source, and they lead to certain ways how the community operates and does things. And I will now talk a little bit about how this is reflected in open source practices. So when you actually do the work, how does that work? And what are the practices which companies are actually looking for? What might be helpful and compatible? On a high level, I would say one of the big achievements of open source as in general is that they have figured out how to collaborate on scale. I put two numbers here, which I find personally completely mind-boggling. The Go ecosystem, it consists of almost 2 million Go packages. Try to organize something which creates 2 million software packages which are able to work together in some way. Same for the Node community, 1.3 million packages. That's really a scale which is amazing and which is really hard to organize. And this happens across boundaries of companies and everything. So this is kind of these numbers are kind of an indication, a proof that open source has figured out how to collaborate at scale. Two more numbers or two more examples, which I think are good examples when you're looking for good open source practices which are compatible with what you might want to have in a company. One is the Kubernetes project. They have this nice statistics site, monthly average of contributors. They have more than 3,000 developers working together on one project. Try to organize that. That's tough. Another example, Visual Studio Code, which is a quite young project. It's not even 5 years old. They have fixed more than almost 8,000 issues in this application. And they have more than 1,000 contributors working on that. And that's amazing, because that's, again, it's one application. Try to organize 1,000 people working on one application. That's hard. With open source, it's possible. And kind of the irony here is that I put up this example as a great example for open source, that it's a project run by Microsoft. They haven't always been that sympathetic to open source. But it's also an indication that open source matters for corporations quite a bit. If Microsoft does it, I mean, that's something where you really can see it has benefits within corporations as well. It's not only this volunteer thing. So let's drill down a little bit more into how does collaboration at scale actually work? And I want to talk about a few practices which I see in open source, and that's not an exhaustive list, but a few examples which I think contribute a lot to this way how you do that, and which are helpful practices you might want to adapt, not only for open source itself. One is this culture of ownership. I already talked a little bit about that when talking about the values. But the culture of ownership, that people feel responsible for what they are doing, that they take ownership in a project, that they come together to work on something because they are motivated to do that, that's something which I think is quite beautiful. And it's also the scratching your own itch. So you feel responsible for your project. You take a part in the ownership. And how to do that, there are certain things, how you can establish that. We already heard a little bit about that from other talks before today. Choose a sane maintainer model. You can choose what suits your project there. What I like is this, those who do the work decide. That's a way how to empower people to take ownership and take responsibility. And showing up in public, signing your work, that's something which also is a sign of your ownership, which gives you reputation, but also gives you maybe the motivation to do a great job. Another practice, which I think is also critical in this broad collaboration, is what I name here peer production. So working together on a project on the same level, so that people come together as individuals. That it's not a complicated corporate setup, a consortium of big companies working together, and you have a lot of roles and different levels, but you get people to work together on the same level. And you can achieve that by focusing on these individuals, not so much about the positions or the affiliation and the corporate background or the hierarchy. And you can see that this works. You have people working in open source projects which are working for companies, which are competitors, which have conflicting interests. But when you put them under this layer of open source values, it's actually possible and productive to work together. A great way how I personally think this is expressed is the Apache way. That's a nice way how to state that. And what I like about that actually is that this is not a recipe or manifest, but it's expressing a culture, how to do that, how to work together on eye level in a very human way. And I want to mention one more thing about this working together as a community of peers. You have to be open for that. The openness is important there. You have to get people in so that you can actually produce these things which can be produced. And open source is one example, but other examples are projects like Wikipedia or OpenStreetMap, where you see, okay, things happen because people work together and it doesn't matter where they are coming from. So diversity is important there. Open source communities are not always diverse in all dimensions. We know that. So work on that. I think that's also quite important. Another practice which I think has emerged in open source community out of necessity is this decentralization. You don't have this one corporate building where people come together, but people work together. They are distributed geographically. They are in different time zones. They don't have guaranteed availability. So you have to figure out how to collaborate in ways which work in such an environment. So writing down things, having asynchronous communication and so on. And one important thing, I think, is coming together in person, like we do here today, but not as a necessity to get any work done, but as a catalyst to trigger the important things you can do in person more effectively and use that to fuel work for a longer time, so that you can actually build up on that and then still work in a decentralized way. Feedback. That's quite general, but I think it's also very apparent in open source as a practice. You have direct feedback. People are working, developers are working directly with users. They get the bug report directly. So that's a wonderful way. I mean, it's a dream for product managers. You get directly the feedback, what works and what not. That also can be a little bit tough. So you have to make sure your people don't wear out, that they don't burn out, that they are not abused. But that's a wonderful feedback cycle, which is essential to improve things and to learn. So from this point of view, open source provides a fantastic environment through this feedback cycle to improve. And if you develop in the open, if you release early and release often, then you get in this cycle where you can actually learn very quickly. Another practice, code sharing. That's kind of the obvious one. Make all the code available you have to everybody, and you will found the base for working together on this. And how to do that is quite easy, actually. You put code under an open source license, you host code on a public platform, so people can collaborate on that. Of course, there's much more of that. You have to make sure that you also build the right culture around that, the right community around that. But this is a wonderful opportunity, because then if you share code, then other people can use your code, they can understand your code, they can fix bugs in your code, and they can contribute these bug fixes. Something which wouldn't be possible without code sharing. And for us as open source people, that sounds quite natural, but it's not the norm if you look into what is happening within companies. Their code sharing is often just difficult. And what effect this can have just one example, the Python requests module. It's one of the most popular modules in the Python ecosystem. And GitHub has introduced this metric where you can see how many repositories are using other repositories. This requests module for doing HTTP requests is used by 455,000 other repositories. That's an amazing number. Try to build a company which sells these successful modules in a way. That's hard. And it's also what I found interesting about this number. I looked this number up a few months ago once. And in the meantime, I think the number has increased by something like 60,000 instances. So there's incredible growth there. That's something where it's code sharing can enable a lot. The Python request module, it's not a company, it's not a product. It's a module other people can use because it's there, because it works, because it's openly accessible. So these practices, culture of ownership, peer production, decentralization, feedback, code sharing, and there are certainly more which you could list there. They result in this collaboration at scale. And what they have in common, and what I think is a key of that, is that they are all based on community, the spirit of open source. It's not only the techniques, how you use, and the special formula, how you arrange things. You need the people behind that, and that's the community. And you have this colorful community which works on things, and if you establish this, then you get the effects of all these practices. So that's a quite important part, because in the end, it's all about people. So, that's all great. How do I get this into my company? Chances are that a lot of that actually already is in your company, because companies are not stupid. I mean, they are doing a lot of things which actually work. And if you look, for example, at agile development, which is kind of a standard way how to develop software in the corporation, a lot of their values, if you look, for example, at the Scrum values, openness is there, commitment is there, transparency is very important there, feedback is very important there. So the same values are propagated as in open source communities. Or if you look at customer focus or time to market, that's a corporate way to talk about, yeah, let's release early and release often. So there actually is quite a bit of overlap. And I think the biggest overlap is in the term collaboration. That's something which is essential for an open source community, but it's also essential for a corporation. And the interesting thing is that the approach is from two different sides. An open source community often starts with a collaboration. It's not, some people come together because they have the same problem and they want to solve this. They share a purpose. They build a small community which grows. So the collaboration is kind of built in. For a corporation, it's often the other way around. They have a framework, they have a system, there's an organization which exists, and they have to organize collaboration. They have to make sure the people have the right environment, have to hire people, and so on. So it's approaching collaboration from two sides, and I think that makes it valuable to look into this combination of open source and corporate values and practices, because that's what corporations can learn from open source. So the way how to do that is, as a company, what if we did open source, but within our company? Because public is scary and we might want to protect our business model, selling licenses. So let's try to get this into the company without going the whole way and doing open source publicly, but try to do that in a confined environment. And that's the inner source tactics I want to talk about. And I consciously put tactics here because I don't think there's a recipe. There's no framework to do inner source where you can say, okay, follow this five things and follow these four rituals and then you will be done and everything is fine. It's the small things you have to integrate into your corporate setup, and every corporate setup is other than others. So you have to look into the details and adapt things. So it's a couple of things you can adapt and try, and it's these tricks which introduce some of the mindset and some of the positive benefits of open source in a company. One of these tactics is create a mental model for what you're doing. And just calling it inner source, I think, is already a nice tactic because that comes with, it sounds like open source, so it sounds open, but it also sounds safe because it's inner, so there's no public involved. That's always good for corporate people. And it gives a common term to talk about this. So it's much easier if I have a conversation about inner source, because then there already comes a lot of connotations and things I can refer to than if I talk about improving collaboration or working a little bit more openly between one team and the other. If I talk about inner source, that makes it easier, because then I have a term I can use and then people know where I'm coming from and what we are talking about. And it gives it a little bit of external authority, which always also is helpful, because it's not me coming with an idea, trying to convince people, but it's something which works for others as well. Code sharing, I talked about that in the context of open source. That's a problem within a company, because often you don't have this one public system, but you have a lot of different systems where people have code. You might not have insight into where code is written. People might not have the permissions to write bug reports for other projects or to look into the code or even contribute a patch. I mean, that would be wonderful if you can fix the bug your colleague has. But in a company setting, sometimes that's just not possible because you don't have the permissions and you have to go through a complicated process to get that. So one tactic to solve that or to improve that is internal code sharing sites. So that's what's happening in a lot of companies. They have their internal GitLab, GitHub, whatever, and this helps. That's the practical part. But also interesting is the legal part. Especially if you have a complex company which might consist of several sub-companies, it's not always clear what are the conditions for sharing code between the different parts. And you have to create contracts and other agreements which regulate how this is happening. So one tactic borrowed from the open source world is write an inner source license, which provides a standard way for different teams, parts of the organization, to share code within a company. And this standardizes things, makes things easier, and clarifies things. We have done this at DB Systel, so we have written an inner source license for the DB group. And the way we did that is we basically started with an open source license and then adapted it to the conditions within the group, because there are certain regulations and that's important. You have to fulfill them, so we wrote a license which reflects that, but still preserves the freedoms you have, but constrained to within the company. And the effects of that is that it's an easy way to clearly express the interest to share. It's a tool for channeling discussions, because we can talk about, are you using the inner source license or not? Why not? What could it be? And so on. So it's an easy way also to express that, put the inner source license in your Git repository. So you can talk more easily about that. And it's a culture trigger, because then you can talk also about these open source culture practices, tactics, and bring them into a company. We have published our inner source license on GitHub, so you can find it there. And actually, for those of you who work with inner source, I would really be interested in discussing this and exchange experience and see how we can learn from each other. Good. Another source of great input for that is the Inner Source Commons website and community. So there are these patterns. We talked about that in the break. I think it's a great resource for these small tactics, how you can apply open source culture within a company. And recently there was the Inner Source Commons Foundation founded, so this is becoming more structured. There's more material there, so I recommend to look at this website. There's a lot of interesting information there. And just three examples for these patterns. And these are small tactics which you can use. For example, the 30-day warranty. If you have teams working together and they might be reluctant to accept a patch because they don't know if the contributor will maintain it, introduce a warranty which clears the expectations where the contributor maintains the patch for a while. Or create an inner source portal so people can find your inner source. Open source is easy because Google and GitHub and others are indexing your code. Within a company, you have to take care of that yourself. Small thing you have to think of when you're doing inner source, but quite important. Or kind of an obvious one or a simple one, praise participants. In a big open source community, you have a lot of people. You get this direct, immediate feedback because you see what people are doing with that. In a corporate context, that's more difficult. So having this as kind of a culture that you praise participants who are contributing to your inner source project can help quite a bit in getting contributors and increasing motivations of people who work there. So what is open source? I think your answer was completely right. It's both. You can find the values of open source on both sides, freedom and control. And a lot of that actually overlaps with what you need and have in corporations and companies as well. So open source is both, make use of it in your context, and that I think will benefit the quality of your products, the happiness of your people, and generally the giving good results. More material about inner source, I would say the most interesting book about that is this Adopting Inner Source book, also available on the Inner Source Commons website. There you will find case studies from a couple of companies who have done open source, who have implemented inner source models using these open source concepts. So that's quite interesting, read up on that, interesting resource. So that's what I wanted to talk about. I'm here. I would be interested in hearing from you what you agree on, what you disagree with. And thanks for being here.
Cornelius, for that. Do we have any questions from the audience here? Anyone? one at the back. We have a few, actually.
Question about internally in DB Systel, do you have to show the like return on investment for inner source somehow?
I would say at the moment we don't have a very structured program there, so it's more like introducing elements we can use. So we don't have full time inner source people or something like that. So the investment actually is there's no massive investment in a way where I would have to justify that. So in this sense, I think it matches very very well the values of the company, also the stated goal to have more collaboration between the different parts of the group and within the company. So there it pays into this goal. The investment discussion then comes when it comes to concrete projects, of course. And that's where it's a little bit more distributed. And also we are, I would say, quite at the beginning. So we are not doing that for the last 20 years, but it's something, the inner source license is one of the earlier steps we have done there. And that's something we have just completed recently, and we will now gain experience with that. But in the end, of course, I mean, we are a company, so we have to justify how we are spending our money, where we are getting it from, and that all that makes economic sense. So this certainly will come, yeah.
I'm wondering, do you have experience how that fits into stuff like Scrum, where everybody's like, oh, but we have this strict backlog and we can't just make something for a different team because obviously we have our stuff going on. And there will usually be a lot of pushback about, no, you can't do that, that's the other the other team's stuff? Like, how do you deal with that?
Yeah, that's certainly a problem. I don't think it's limited to Scrum. I think it's with all collaboration within a company. You will always have to answer the question, okay, it's not directly serving your next goal, your next milestone, so is it worth the effort? I think there are several ways how to approach that, and that really depends how also teams do that and how they can convince their customers, their stakeholders, that actually contributing is helpful. We have this example of in the open source world, you can fix a bug. If you don't contribute it back, you will have to fix it again when there's the next open source release. You have the same argumentation with in a company and between teams as well. So collaboration has a value. If you can show in a Scrum world, if the product owner sees that and sees that this actually is creating value, then it's easier to face that into the development. If not, then you have maybe to find other ways how to do that, and maybe to give explicit freedom to people so that they can, I don't know, use some unaccounted time to do that, or create special programs where you have dedicated time to do that and stuff like that. I think it's really a problem, but it's a problem of making people understand, because I think there are good reasons, which then in the end also will show up on the bottom line, that collaboration creates value and doesn't cost time.
Do you, if I may follow up on that, do you have programs targeted at people to really make them understand, hey, source is there, go use it, like to get them started? So to give an example, there's a company which has everything, all the code is online for everybody to see in the company, but nobody actually contributes to anything else but their own stuff. Like, how do you get people to start doing that?
Yeah, that's, as I said, we are getting started with that, so my experience concrete with inner source code is quite limited there in this context, but in general, it's a general problem, of course. I mean, sharing of knowledge, sharing of also motivation and so on. So at DB System, we are in the process of going through a transformation to transfer the company to something which is more organized like a network. So we have a lot of events where people get together, where people can work on focused things, and this helps a lot. I think building this, it's a little bit like introducing some of these values of open source culture as well. Like, how do you communicate effectively? How can you make people aware? How you being open, being transparent, which makes it easy to find people. But you certainly also will have to help with things like creating portals where you can find things if Google is not able to index your stuff and so on. Yeah.
Yeah, so how, from what I understood, inner source is like learning from open source, from the open source community, and adopting best practices into the inside of an organization. Do you expect also benefits then from that go back outside to the outside of the organization? And what would that be? For example, in the active process of adopting a license to your software, is then a free software license an option or stuff like that?
I think it's, on one hand, if you keep things internally, you don't have this direct benefit of becoming open. And the inner source license is an inner source license. You can't just release it openly. That's not possible. But I would say adopting the practices which are related to that, for example, caring about the copyright, expressing that, making clear who has the rights on a certain piece of code, putting copyright notices into the code files and so on. All these are practices which help with also a process like open sourcing something. And if people learn how these things work using that within this protected context of a company in a kind of an inner source program, I think that helps a lot, because that's part of the education they need anyway to be able to contribute to open source projects. So from this point of view, I think it can be seen as this kind of doing a baby step into the direction of open source, but it's not necessary that it ends there. It's also okay if it stays inside. Obviously, the potential of working with the world is bigger than working with the people within a company, but still, it's an improvement if people actually do that and share within a company.
Thanks, Cornelius. So you just already said that it's kind of just starting in the company, so maybe I should ask this a year from now, but how frustrating is it?
If you ask me personally, I think the frustration level of different people is different, also in what motivates them, also in what they find challenging. If you have some patience and don't expect results within a few weeks, then I think it's not frustrating at all, but it's promising, it's rewarding, it's challenging. So that's, I think, the part which is quite interesting. Big organizations are hard to move. There's a lot of mass which has to be moved, but there's a lot of potential. And that's what I personally find interesting. Other people might perceive that differently and might find it more interesting if they have to go through the exercise of writing a license. I mean, that's something I would personally not recommend anybody to do unless you really want to do it. But if you do it, it's fun.
Any more questions? Okay, if not, thank you very much, Cornelius, for that.
Thank you.